Welcome back. So far, we have assumed that control and states are not bounded. So whenever we are solving optimal control problem based on the variational principle, at that time, we are assuming that control as well as states are unbounded. But if you see the realistic problem, so that kind of assumption are not a valid assumption. So we have to again relook the problem such that we have certain kind of constraint on the control as well as some kind of constraint on the states. So most of time or several large classes of problem, in order to implement some kind of control, it is possible to show that our control should be bounded. And due to that reason, now again we have to relook the optimal control problem, and problem statement is now one can formulate like this, that I have given system. So is it possible to formulate some kind of optimal control for that particular system which is able to minimize some kind of performance measure? So let us first try to see whatever we have done till now. So far I have assumed that I have some kind of non-autonomous system x dot equal to ax plus b ax plus ut, and t is explicitly present here. I am assuming that xt belongs to Rn and u belongs to Rm, and I have this kind of generalized performance measure where this is terminal cost. And after that, now I have certain kind of a specification about the boundary condition. We are assuming that initial time t0 as well as initial state x0 is known to me. Similarly, here I am assuming that tf, final time, is at final time I have xf, final position is xf, or final state is xf, either that is free or tf is free. Sometime both are also free. So in this way we are specifying the boundary condition, and in order to obtain the optimal control, what basically we are doing, we are defining the Hamiltonian function. And I have several time I have repeated that Hamiltonian function. In order to define Hamiltonian function, we are collected this term, and after that we are actually multiplying PT, either you can interpret this PT as a Lagrange multiplier or some kind of co-state variable. So, and dimension of this co-state variable is same like dimension of XT. And after that, this is coming from the dynamics. So in this way, we are defining the Hamiltonian function. And once Hamiltonian function is defined, after that, we are talking about the necessary condition for the existence of optimal control U star. And we have seen that in order to find that optimal control, we have to solve a state equation. And a state equation one can easily formulate by solving this kind of partial differential equation, means partial differential equation of Hamiltonian with respect to the co-state variable. And after that, one can obtain the supportive equation, that is equation of co-state, by taking partial derivative of Hamiltonian with respect to state or optimal state x star here that we have represented with negative sign. And in order to find the control, we have to solve this algebraic equation. First, I have to take partial derivative with respect to u star, and after that one algebraic equation comes into picture. And if you solve that algebraic equation, then you will get the control. And in this whole process, I am assuming that there is no constraint on the state, or either on the state or on the control. And we have to also solve some kind of boundary condition that is called generalized boundary condition, which is actually incorporated the change with respect to the final state as well as final time. Because I have told you that in some case I have flexibility that one quantity is known, means final time is known but final state is not known. Sometime final state is not known but final time is unknown, and in some case we have both are unknown. At that time I need this kind of generalized basically boundary condition. And if you see carefully, then in order to generate this boundary condition, we have used this terminal cost and we have calculated a derivative of terminal cost with respect to x, and after that we are subtracting the co-state variable. And similarly here I have another quantity, that is partial derivative of that final terminal cost with respect to tau, and after that we are adding the Hamiltonian function. Here x star, u star, p star all are the optimal value or optimal trajectory, optimal control trajectory, or p star tf is the optimal co-state variable. And I have already told you several times, I have repeated that remark, is that we assume that control ut and state xt are unconstrained, means there is no constraint. You can take any value of control input and any value of state xt. So this is the way we are formulating the theory. First we are assuming that everything is flexible, and after that slowly we are actually converging towards the constraint, our realistic constraint, those kind of constraint which is basically feasible to implement. And I have already told you that basically in reality the physical system to be controlled in an optimal manner have some constraint on their input and their internal variable. So we have some kind of limitations, and this limitation basically comes into picture due to safety factor, because somewhere if some variable will exceed, then that create some kind of safety issue. They might damage some part of the system, and in that way that system may become broken, and that damage the other part of the whole system. After that cost and another type of inherent limitation, and due to that reason, whenever we are formulating the optimal control problem, at that time we have to equally take care about the input constraint as well as internal variable, means a state constraint or output constraint. Here I am assuming that all state variable are reflected on the output. So let us try to see some kind of physical example where this kind of restriction comes into picture. So this is, if you see this era, so this era is too much dominated by robotics. And if you see the robot, then one of the very famous actuator which is using inside the robot, that is DC motor. And most of time, in order to do position control, whenever position control problem that is evolved for robotics or other classes of problem, where basically input voltage to field or armature circuit are limited to some standard value. Means their voltage is not basically exceed from this particular value, or they have some kind of a specific number. So this should be not exceed than this particular value. Also, if you see that their magnetic flux in the field circuit that saturate after a certain value of field current, and due to that reason we have certain kind of inherent limitation on the input, and since that magnetic flux also saturate after certain value of field current, so I have some kind of limitation with respect to states also. If you consider field current as a one of the state variable, then now Another example, that if you talk about the rocket engine, and inside rocket engine actually we have fuel, and based on fuel basically we are generating the thrust, and using thrust we are able to maintain our objective. And most of time rocket is designed in such a fashion such that thrust has certain kind of limitations. Now I have to actually design rocket in such a way such that whatever thrust that is created by the rocket engine, that should not exceed from certain magnitude, otherwise we have always fuel limitation. So I cannot assume that rocket can able to apply any kind of thrust. It means that control is also limited in this that particular example. Similarly, if we have to do a speed control, sometime most of time we are using electric motor for position control as well as a speed control. So a speed also has certain kind of limitation, that a speed of an electric motor used in a typical speed control system cannot exceed a certain value without damaging the some of the mechanical components. So if that speed is beyond certain value, then it might possible some part, mechanical part might be affected, that is bearing or shaft of the mechanical system, and due to that reason we have limitation, inherent limitation on the speed of the electric motor. So we have constraint, we have certain kind of constraint on state in this particular classes of problem. After that, similarly, whenever we are talking about a spacecraft, so their re-entering mission means, suppose that a spacecraft we have fired to moon, and after that that containing some kind of man, or we have man mission or some particular mission, where what happens that we want to again call that particular spacecraft to the ground or earth atmosphere. At that time again we have certain limitations or certain specification with respect to attitude as well as velocity. If we do not put that kind of constraint, then what happens that descending, re-entering a spacecraft might damage, and it might possible that is burn also, and due to that reason we have some kind of limitation. And now let us come to the problem. So now idea is that we have certain kind of system, we have now constraint on the control or constraint on the state or both, then how to solve that classes of problem, or how to relook the fundamental lemma, fundamental theorem of the calculus of variation, or how to generalize fundamental theorem of calculus of variation such that particular theorem will generate some kind of necessary condition and takes care about the constraint with respect to input, constraint with respect to a state. And if you see that classes of problem, so one of the great contribution that is given by this scientist name is Pontryagin, and that principle is become famous by Pontryagin minimum principle. And in this lecture I am going to highlight the result which is actually driven whatever result that is given by Pontryagin and their co-researchers. So first try to understand the objective of this lecture. So now in this lecture we have to consider the effect of control constraint on the fundamental theorem, because in fundamental theorem we know that if first variation equal to zero, then that particular functional contain some kind of extremum value. So now what we have to do, we have to see that fundamental theorem again, such that if there exists some kind of constraint, then how to modify fundamental theorem such that we can again able to state the result, means we are again able to talk about the extremum value of that particular functional. So and actually that result leads to the Pontryagin minimum principle. So let us try to see from the definition. We know that something has relative minima, and here what we are actually going to denote that I have some kind of control U star, and that particular control is going to minimize some kind of performance measure. So most of time whenever we are designing some kind of control action for some particular system, we have some specification of the performance measure, and we have to design control, we have to select control such that we are able to minimize that particular performance measure or particular functional. And if you see the definition, then we are telling that the control U star causes the functional J to have a relative minima if this kind of condition is satisfied. So what we have done, we have calculated the increment delta J. If that is greater than equal to 0, then we are telling that U star is basically the relative minima. So for all admissible control that is sufficiently close to U star, so what we will do, in the vicinity of U star, we will put several value, and if this relation will satisfy, then we are able to become conform from the definition that particular U star is nothing but relative minima. So this is a standard fact from the definition. Now what we are going to do, we are going to express same kind of things in terms of the variation. So I am going to perturb my control U star plus delta U. Delta U is the perturbation. So and after that, it is possible to show that increment of J can be expressed in terms of first variation plus higher order term. We have already seen this. So whenever we are talking about increment, so that is equal to the first variation and plus higher order term. And first variation, one can able to express using this way, that is dou J by dou U, because we are calculating variation with respect to U, we are designing U, and after that by tuning U, we want to minimize something, and due to that reason we have calculated the partial derivative with respect to U, and after that I have, so this is the Jacobian, and after that delta UT. Now you try to see here that delta J, this quantity is linear in delta U, and the higher order term approaches 0 as the norm of delta U approaches 0. It means that if you do this kind of process, so somehow we are actually calculating the higher order approximation, linear approximation of some particular functional J. And if U star and U plus delta U, that is very, very close, then it is possible to show that relation between this delta J and delta UT are basically linear. So same kind of things, if we have unbounded case. Unbounded case means if I am able to select any amount of control, means my control is unbounded. So if the control were unbounded, we could use the linearity of delta J with respect to delta U. And fact is that I can able to vary delta U, because there is no constraint. So I can tell that I can arbitrarily able to vary the delta u, and in this way I can able to state the necessary condition for the optimality, that extremal u star to be extremal we have already seen from the fundamental theorem of the calculus of variation, that this particular variation, first variation, that should be zero, provided I have some kind of flexibility on u star. We are telling that there is no constraint on u star, so I will calculate, I will see the increment with respect to u of that particular functional, and after that, that is equivalent to the first variation plus higher order variation. So I will neglect higher order variation, and if that first order variation that equal to zero for all small variation of u star, then I can able to claim that u star is nothing but some kind of extremal control. Now try to see the constraint case. So in constraint case, controls are not unbounded, that is basically bounded. So controls are basically bounded, and du is arbitrary only if the extremal is extremal is strictly within the boundary for all t that is lie between t0 to tf. So let us try to see this particular figure, then things become clear. Suppose I have some system and I am able to apply this amount of control ut. So now I have certain kind of physical restriction. I can only able to generate this much amount of control. So you can see that here between t0 to tf in this time interval, I am only able to apply control amount which lie below this blue region. So this is admissible region, and whatever if we will go up of this, then that is inadmissible region. So I cannot able to generate control beyond this particular point. So maximum value of control, whatever we are going to generate, that basically lie inside this. Now suppose that if I have certain kind of variation here, this is admissible boundary. So if I select u star, and if that is within the range, so you can see that variation, both side variation is allowed, plus delta u and minus delta u. If I know this is u star, so both side variation is allowed. But here you can see that if you do u star minus delta u, whatever same way we are defining here, then that is not allowed. Means I have only allowed variation in this particular direction. So arbitrary variation is not allowed, and due to that reason we have retained this particular point, that control are bounded, du is arbitrary only if the extremal control is strictly within the boundary. If that is strictly within the boundary, then there is no problem. So upper variation plus lower variation is allowed. However, if an extremal control lies on a boundary during at least one sub interval, means any time interval, for if that control, I am telling that the out of the all possible control action, this particular control action that will satisfy the optimality condition. So this is my optimal control. But this particular time interval, now if you see this time interval t1 to t2, so that is going to lie on the boundary. So if we have this kind of situation, then you can see that then admissible control variation delta u cap exists, whose negative minus delta u are not admissible. Means either minus delta u is not admissible or plus delta u is not admissible. It means that I cannot able to vary control in arbitrary fashion, and due to that reason we have some kind of restriction whenever we are talking about the constrained case. In an unconstrained case, there is no problem. If inside the boundary, even if control is bounded, then also that is not a problem. Only problem is that when you are in bound, you are at boundary, and in this particular situation, how to modify the necessary condition? That is the main motive of the today's lecture. So what we have seen, that an extremal control that is constrained by a boundary. So this figure is basically showing that particular case. And after that, now what kind of variation is admissible in this particular case? So if you are inside the admissible region, then both variation is okay. But if you are at the boundary, then that kind of things is not okay. So in that particular case, how to solve or how to redefine the necessary condition? And in this particular case, a necessary condition for U star to minimize is J. Now I cannot claim that delta J, that is first variation, that equal to 0 for all a small value of delta U cap. At that time, I can just only able to claim that should be greater than equal to 0. And from here, from the definition, it is pretty clear that if you see the definition, please come here, that you can see that whenever we are stating the definition, at that time we are calculating the difference between JU minus JU star, and that should be greater than equal to 0. So what we are telling, that delta JU with respect to U star, that should be always greater than equal to 0, that not equal to 0, because now I have some kind of constraint on the control. So directly now I cannot modify the result. I can tell that a necessary condition for U star to minimize on J in whole interval we are talking, that is this only. So it might possible if we are within the region, then equality sign is there. But if we are at boundary, then I cannot claim that first variation with respect to delta U, that is equal to 0. So now what we are telling, that variation of delta U cap something which are non-zero only for T not in the interval. It means that this interval only, what we have observed, that control or optimal control on the boundary of the admissible or non-admissible region. But apart from this, that is pretty safe. So any kind of variation is allowed for any kind of sufficiently small variation is allowed. And at that time, I can state the similar kind of condition or similar kind of theorem, that first order variation equal to 0 for all admissible variation of the delta U star, all small admissible variation of U star. So now let us come to the main result of the today's lecture. So considering all admissible variation with delta U is small enough so that sign of delta J is determined by delta J, because we know the relation between increment and variation. So what we have to make sure, that sign of these two quantity, because delta J should be greater than equal to 0, so at the same time delta J, that should be greater than equal to 0. So at that time, necessary condition U star to minimize J is given by this. So that is directly from the definition. Let us try to see the relation between calculus versus variational calculus. Then you are easily able to understand why this kind of condition basically appeared. So suppose in calculus we have learned that suppose we have certain kind of function, and if that function is lie between, suppose this is t and this is ft, and if function lie between here to here, and suppose if I have to find the minima or maxima, for example, then basically we are finding maxima and minima inside this interval where t0 and tf is not included, and after that we have to take care about the endpoint also. So at that time, if we are generating the necessary condition for function f as a relative minima, at that time we have to see the both endpoint, because in this endpoint only I can talk about t0 plus delta t. Here I cannot talk about tf plus delta t. I only able to talk about tf minus delta t. And due to that reason, we have retained that admissible delta t greater than equal to 0. So if you are at this point, t0 point, then whatever variation in t0, that should be greater than 0. So that should satisfy the definition of the minima of the function, and df is basically derivative there. Now similarly, I am going to see the derivative at the final point, and at that time delta t should be less than 0. So only I am going to see from left side. I am not going to look into right side of the tf. So inside, from this side up to this side, what happens that again this condition should be satisfied. And in this way, basically the a necessary condition for f to have a relative minima at any interior point. So this is a story about the exterior point. So exterior point, this inequality should be satisfied, but interior point, that differential for all t between t0 to tf, that equal to 0. So I have problem with the endpoint only. So similar kind of things for the control problem, I have an analogous necessary condition, that for control problem, necessary condition is like this. If u star lie on the boundary during any portion of the time interval, if that will not lie on the boundary, then condition is simply that first variation, that equal to 0. So if u star lie within the boundary during the entire time interval t0 to tf, then there is no need to worry. Constraint problem or unconstrained problem, both can solve in the similar fashion. Just you have to put the first variation, that is equal to 0. But if at the any time sub interval, if that is on boundary, then we have to make sure that will satisfy this kind of inequality. Now let us try to see that how one can mathematically incorporate or restate the necessary condition when some kind of constraint with respect to control. Here in this portion I am just talking about constraint with respect to control. I am not going to take care about the constraint with respect to a state. So we are assuming that a state can evolve anywhere, but I can only able to apply the limited amount of control. That kind of restriction we have. Now let us try to see that if you calculate the first variation. So what basically we are doing, we are defining the Hamiltonian function. So Hamiltonian definition of Hamiltonian function is exactly same like unconstrained case. So due to that reason I haven't written here, and this part basically I have taken from the previous lecture, that variation of j. So I have variation with respect to delta x, I have variation with respect to dt, I have variation with respect to delta u, and after that I have variation with respect to delta xf. Now, in this whole things, if you look carefully, then again, you can see that I have, whenever we are talking about the optimal control problem, at that time, certain necessary conditions should be satisfied. So if optimal state X star, that should satisfy this equation, X dot star T, that is partial derivative with partial derivative of Hamiltonian with respect to co-state variable or Lagrange variable, you can tell. So if this equality holds, at that time you can see that this term is going to vanish, because delta PT might be any arbitrary, and due to that reason I cannot force this equal to zero. Due to that reason, this equal to zero. Similarly, you can see that co-state equation, second equation, delta XT might be any arbitrary. Due to that reason, this should be zero, and from that we are getting some kind of co-state equation and co-state equation. So same kind of things we have written here. If the co-state P star is selected so that the coefficient of the dependent variation delta XT in the integrand is identically zero, then co-state equation can be stated like this. And several times we have used this equation. So now I hope you become familiar. And after that, we are stating the boundary condition. So in boundary condition, this should be satisfied. This is also called generalized boundary condition. So boundary condition is selected such that it result in the auxiliary boundary condition, and that is with respect to delta XF and delta TF. So either final time or final position is specified or not specified. So if you put everything in the first variation of J, it is possible to show that finally only one term is going to remains, that is this particular term. Because this term equal to zero, this term equal to zero, and after that this will give us the boundary condition. This quantity will gives us the boundary condition. So extra quantity we have just added, that is control, and so this is the partial derivative of Hamiltonian with respect to control, and this is the variation. So now by considering these all three things, you can see that when the previous items are satisfied, then first variation, now that is only in terms of the U. So, and if you see the problem statement, so problem statement is only I have some kind of constraint on U, and then I have to restate the problem of the or fundamental principle of the variation. So now let us try to see that the integrand in the previous relation, this relation, is the first order approximation. This is the first order approximation to change the Hamiltonian of H due to the change of UT alone. So we are just seeing, because after solving the state equation, co-state equation, boundary condition, so only one part is remaining. Basically, if U is any arbitrary, at that time we are just solving dou H by dou U equal to zero, and that will give us the control. But here I cannot vary delta U arbitrary, at least at boundary I cannot vary, and due to that reason now this term is going to remains inside the integral. So we have to take care whenever we are talking about the necessary condition, and due to that reason only this term is important for us in order to talk about the optimal control. And let us try to see the further interpretation of this term. You can see that this means that if you just concentrate on the integrand term, then this particular things is nothing but the, if you change U star by delta U, so in that way also I can write. So U delta U is very, very sufficiently small, then I can able to write this whole expression like this. And Now what I am going to do, I am just going to substitute that expression here in place of dou h by dou u and delta u. So I am going to substitute this. So now necessary condition is just that we have to make sure that this should be greater than or equal to 0. So now some integrand should be greater than or equal to 0 for all t that is lie between t0 to tf. So it means that for all admissible delta u less than a small value, very very small value, I have to make sure that should be greater than or equal to 0. And from here you can see that if this inequality will satisfy, if this value is greater than or equal to this value, then whatever the first variation, this is the equation of first variation, that should be greater than or equal to 0. Just I have to make sure that this is optimal control, and if you add anything inside the optimal control, then that is always take some kind of higher value, that is the meaning. So this is the minimum value. So now what you can do, you can replace u star by delta u, that is by general u. So for all u, if this relation will satisfy, that will gives us the necessary condition. So if for all u it will satisfy, it means that if you make u equal to u star plus delta u, also that is satisfied, and due to that reason, in this way we have generated the necessary condition. So if I have no constraint, then this necessary condition is pretty easy. You have to just see the partial derivative of dou Hamiltonian dou h by dou u that equal to 0. In that way I can generate the control. But now in order to generate the control, we have to make sure that for all ut, whatever control, and if u star is the optimal one, then that will satisfy this kind of inequality. So above equation indicates that an optimal control must minimize the Hamiltonian, and this is called Pontryagin minimum principle. From this particular equation, that is clear, that because what we are telling, that for all u this inequality should be satisfied. It means that if this necessary condition will satisfy, then obviously Hamiltonian is going to minimize, and due to that reason this is called Pontryagin minimum principle. Now one more important point I am going to highlight, this above condition is just necessary condition. This is not in general a sufficient condition for the optimality. What does it mean that this is just necessary condition? You can see that an optimal control must satisfy this particular principle, that Pontryagin minimum principle. And what is minimum Pontryagin minimum principle? That whatever Hamiltonian, so that Hamiltonian should be minimized. Minimized means if u star is optimal control, then at that particular moment that Hamiltonian functional that should contain the minimum value. That only I have to make sure for all u, whatever variation we have u, and this gives us the necessary condition. However, there may be control that satisfy the minimum principle that not optimal. So sometime if you see control, then that will satisfy this inequality, this particular inequality, but they may not satisfy other equality, because in order to derive this particular relation, we have three more assumptions, that state equation should be satisfied, co-state equation should be satisfied, generalized boundary condition should be satisfied. So it might possible some control may satisfy this particular condition, but they may not satisfy other three equality condition. Due to that reason, even just by checking this, I cannot tell that u star is the optimal. and same kind of things, and due to that reason we are telling that necessary condition is okay, but this necessary condition may or may not be the sufficient. Now I am going to summarize whatever we have done till now. That problem statement is that I have some kind of admissible control and admissible bounded control which cause the system. I have non-autonomous system where xt belongs to Rn and ut belongs to Rm to follow a admissible trajectory that minimize the performance measure. And again, I have defined performance measure in this particular way. And after that, what basically we are doing, how to solve this problem? We are telling you can define the Hamiltonian. So Hamiltonian I have defined again by taking the integrand term, after that coset variable, and dimension of coset variable is same as the dimension of a state. And after that I am multiplying coset variable with the dynamics, and after that we are stating the optimal or necessary condition for the optimality or optimal control. So this is the state equation, this is the co-state equation, several times I have written. Now in place of the control, where in unconstrained case we are telling that dou h by dou u that is equal to zero, now I have to make sure that this relation will satisfy for all u. This relation should satisfy, and this all equations should be satisfied for all t between t0 to tf, because my starting point is t0 and final point is tf. So we are just concentrated on these two interval, we are not worrying beyond this. And obviously I have generalized boundary condition. So in this way, what we have observed, that in case of unconstrained case or constrained case, everything remains the same, just I have one modification here. And this result is actually, if you see carefully, then also they contain the constraint, unconstrained case, because in unconstrained case this is obvious. Now let us try to see that. First I will give some emphasis, and after that I will tell you that how basically I am telling that using that necessary condition, whatever necessary condition I have stated, in particular necessary condition that is also enough whenever we are talking about the unconstrained case. So here you can see that U star is a control that causes this particular Hamiltonian to assume, to assure its global or absolute minimum. We have already seen this. And above equation constitute a set of necessary condition for optimality that is not generally sufficient. I have already talked about this point, why this is just sufficient, why this is just necessary, not a sufficient, because several necessary condition occur together, and after that they will generate some kind of sufficient condition. Sometimes several necessary condition, they come together and they will generate some kind of necessary condition again. So for U star to be minimized the Hamiltonian, and suppose now I have some kind of unconstrained case, so I can assume that is constrained by some kind of large number, very very large number. So that is unconstrained, so this relation should be satisfied, dou h by dou u equal to zero. And after that second condition, that is sufficient condition, their second partial derivative of h with respect to u, that is positive definite, that is the sufficient condition. And this guarantee that u star causes h to be local minima if the Hamiltonian, if you express the Hamiltonian like this, I have some kind of system where I can able to express this is the dynamics of the system, and after that I define some kind of variable ct ut, and after that I have control, and I have some kind of a specification with respect to these two quantity, these two matrix. So what I am assuming, that c, that is m cross one matrix, doesn't have any term containing ut. So that kind of things we are assuming. This term, you can see that just contain xt and pt. So by solving these two condition, that is necessary and sufficient condition, at least in unconstrained case, I can able to find the global minima and global minima, because if you take two time partial derivative, then only RT is going to appear, and this RT, if that is positive definite, then I can tell that this particular, by solving dou H by dou U, if you solve dou H by dou U and rearrange term, then you are able to see this kind of optimal control. So in this way, by using the same set of necessary condition and stating adding one more condition, I can talk about necessary and sufficient condition in case of the unconstrained case. Obviously, in constrained case, I cannot able to talk about the sufficient condition. Now, before concluding this lecture, I am going to solve one problem, both for constrained and unconstrained case. So I have taken again very simple example, that is second order system, that is represented by second order system. Initial condition that is given by xt0, ut I am assuming that is just a scalar quantity. So I have two states and one input, and after that, now I have defined the performance measure. Inside performance measure, I am assuming that I have just one state. Second state, you can assume that some kind of problem where velocity is not relevant if you represent x1 dot equal to x2 and x2 dot equal to something. And suppose x1 is position and x2 is the velocity. So velocity is not so much relevant in order to decide the cost. At that time, you can decide it control like this, something like that. And TF is specified, and final state XTF is free. So that kind of boundary condition, because I have already told you that I have a state equation, co-state equation. After that, I have boundary condition, generalized boundary condition, and we have just modification in control in case of constrained and unconstrained case. So in case of constraint, I have to decide control by Pontryagin minimum principle. But in unconstrained case, I have to just solve dou h is Hamiltonian with respect to u equal to 0. So now I am going to solve two different problems. So in first set of problem, what I am going to assume that I have to find the necessary condition for constrained control to minimize j I have already defined. So first I form the Hamiltonian. I have already told you that formulation of Hamiltonian is very simple. First, you can collect whatever term that is inside the integrand. So here you can see that in this particular problem, I have half x1 square plus half u square that I'm going to take inside the Hamiltonian. And after that, I'm going to multiply whatever right hand side of this with p1, whatever here with p2. So basically, this kind of Hamiltonian function comes into picture, and after that I have to solve four basically equations. So this is co-state equation. So and after that state equation is already solved, so there is no need to solve. And after that, in order to calculate the control, I have to take the partial derivative of Hamiltonian with respect to u, and in this way I can able to calculate the control by putting Hamiltonian, partial derivative of Hamiltonian with respect to u equal to 0. So in this way, I am able to get this control. One can also check that dou 2h by dou u square, that is 1, that is greater than 1. And due to that reason, we are telling that whatever control that u star equal to minus p2 star means second co-state variable, that going to minimize that particular performance measure. And boundary condition, if you put the boundary condition, because I have already stated the boundary condition here inside this problem. So inside this problem, you can see that TF is specified. So if TF is specified, then variation of TF with respect to means delta TF that equal to 0. And final state XTF is free. So variation of delta XTF is any arbitrary. So whatever multiplication of delta xf, that should be 0. And if you put that kind of things, then it is possible to show that at the final time TF, because boundary condition we are solved only at the final time. So P star TF equal to 0. So in this way, we are able to find the optimal control. So optimal control, finally, you can see that when we are at TF, at that time control value equal to 0. Now, I am going to change the statement of my problem. What I am going to do, I am going to constrain my control, and I am assuming that my control is bounded between minus 1 to 1. Now, if control is bounded between minus 1 to 1, then state and co-state equation for boundary condition for P star TF remains unchanged. So all three equation, state equation, co-state equation, and boundary condition remains the same. Now, just I have to select U, which is going to minimize the Hamiltonian function. So first you can write the Hamiltonian function at the when trajectory is the optimal, when P star means when co-state value is optimal. And now out of this, just because we are going to see variation with respect to U, so there is no need to worry about whole term. Just you can collect those kind of term which contain the U. So I am going to separate U, and after that, now what we have to do, that I have to make sure that UT should be lie between minus 1 to 1. So it means that here in this particular solution, first I will again calculate the unsaturated case. Unsaturated case means those kind of case when basically value of P2 is lie between minus 1 to 1. That is permissible. Beyond that, only we will touch the boundary condition. So if U star that lie between less than equal to minus 1, at that time I can apply this amount of control. But now you try to see that, suppose if P star T that is greater than 1, then condition is violated. And from here, I have to see the situation. Suppose if P star T that is greater than 1, then from this form, control should be, since maximum value of control that is minus 1 plus 1. So whenever we are at boundary, and if P star T that is greater than 1, then I will select minus 1. And if that is less than 1, then I will select plus 1. So in this way, I can able to design some kind of saturated control, saturated optimal control, and sometime this saturated optimal control is able to fulfill our objective. Sometime it is not always, sometime it is also not able to fulfill the objective. So after designing this, because this is just necessary condition, so we have to check it. Now what happens, that after deriving this result, and you can see that this result become very much famous. Why that becomes so much famous? Because by simple modification, you can see that everything remains the same. They have just modified the condition with respect to control. So initially, that is, I have to solve partial derivative of Hamiltonian with respect to control, that equal to 0. Now we have to just solve one inequality. So for all u, I have to find that whatever that Hamiltonian function that contain minimum value. Since almost all practical system has constraint, some kind of control constraint, due to that reason, this result become too much famous. After that, Pontryagin and their co-worker has also written several paper. I'm not going to prove all, just I'm going to highlight some more additional necessary condition for different condition. So one result that is become very much famous, that if the final time is fixed, so final time is specified, and Hamiltonian, whatever Hamiltonian function that doesn't explicitly depending on time, means that is independent of the time. So at that time, it is possible to show that Hamiltonian function must be constant when evaluated on the extremal trajectory. So that kind of result that is proved by him, that if Hamiltonian function is not explicitly depending on time and final time is fixed, then it is possible to show that Hamiltonian function is constant on the boundary, or the extremal trajectory, you can tell. And if final time is free, suppose now final time is free, and Hamiltonian, again, if that is not explicitly depending on time, then Hamiltonian must be identically zero when evaluated on the extremal trajectory. So that should be zero. So these two results I have stated without any proof. So most of time, general Hamiltonian function is function of time, but it is possible to show that several time my system is basically not time varying, that is time invariant, linear or non-linear. At that time, that is independent, my Hamiltonian function is independent of the time. At that time, not explicitly depending on the time, at that time these two results are more relevant. So now I am going to conclude the today's lecture. So in this lecture, what we have observed, that whenever I have to solve some kind of optimal control problem, at that time I have two different kind of situation. In first situation, it might possible control has certain limitation. Sometime I am assuming that control, I have enough amount of control, I can apply any amount of control. So if I have that much of flexibility, then necessary condition for the existence of optimal control, I have to solve a state equation, co-state equation, one equation that is partial derivative of H with respect to u equal to 0, and after that generalized boundary condition. But suppose I have some kind of restriction, then at that time I have to modify necessary condition. It means that whatever fundamental theorem of calculus variation, that calculus of variation, that is modified in order to incorporate this kind of constraint with respect to control. And that is very, very simple. I have to make sure that Hamiltonian function or Hamiltonian functional, that is minimized with respect to that particular control. And if that happens with all three condition is also equally satisfied, then we are claiming that that particular control, that particularly bound, that particular bounded control is going to minimize or going to extremize that particular performance measure. So with this remark, I am going to close the today's lecture. So thank you very much.